Cara and to Alastair.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you. Firstly, a minor confession. This is some work that Cara and I have done together. Have you ever had one of those nightmares when you're giving a lecture to like an audience who knows loads more about the subject than you are, and they're all really clever, and you know nothing? That's me. I'm not a listener. I've never listened
to... I know! Be really nice to you.
I'm going to have to now, aren't I? Yes, so there's a reason for this, but of course Cara, as you know, is a huge fan, so we collaborated. There's a good reason why I'm not a listener, which we'll come on to. So I'm going to try and...
Yeah, things like that, they're quite accidental puns, okay?
Oh, I did, didn't I?
Yes,
I didn't mean to do that. Right, so, yes, I'm going to try and convince you that this has intellectual merit, which some of you may not think so, judging by the reaction we got to the survey. So, I'm a psychologist, a cognitive scientist. My main area is the idea of two-process minds. That is, that we are can model the mind in as an idea that we have two processes going on. First one is kind of a cognitive, thinking, reasoned, rational way. We can introspect, we can understand, we can come to rational, reasoned conclusions. I'm more interested in the intuitive stuff, which are essentially expressed by what are called heuristics, and these are mental shortcuts that our mind just does, and it allows us to make quick decisions. But we may not be aware, we may be aware of the outcome of them, but we may not be aware of the stuff that goes on that causes them. And there's a lot of data about all these different kind of heuristics. And I'm building a body of evidence that perhaps this thing to do with penis size and something is one of these heuristics. Let me explain. So we're probably all aware of the idea that there are certain gentlemen of colour tend to be thought of as having large penises. This is the Limpid Christie waxwork in Madame Tussauds. I was paying for my education ages ago doing TV production work, and I noted that this guy was the one who was most physically abused in Madame Tussauds, mainly because people just couldn't resist having a go at his lunchbox. But this idea of black penis size is untrue. A study done in 2015 showed there was no there's no difference between ethnicities and penis size. So where does it come from? Well, actually, it's got some really sinister roots, because it comes from the slave trade, when they were trying to bestialise the idea that slaves weren't actually human, they were more like beasts, and because of this, they had strong libidos, because they had strong libidos, they had large genitalia, and that's where it comes from. So it's really sinister. But this chap, a guy I saw speak with, got me thinking about this a long time ago, and Leon Kamin, basically said, well, this is a very irrational thing to say. I mean, why should any kind of sort of cognitive mental function be related to genital size? And he came up with this idea that maybe there was something to do with fear and intimidation, and perhaps it was an expression of fear and intimidation that was somehow expressed through thinking that somebody had a large penis. And this is sort of, there's some evidence for this in kind of history as well. There's lots of difference, but this is sort of analogous. I mean, I know there are people who know the subject way more than I do here, but there's certainly evidence even back in Roman and Greek culture that they would portray those who were barbarians having large penises and themselves as having small penises, because it was considered as being kind of less barbaric. So it's maybe there's a comparison there. And there also might be some evidence in biology as well, because if you look at sort of human body size compared to the other great apes, we're relatively small. We're actually, when you look at willy size, we're doing pretty well against gorillas, guys. So there is this kind of thought that, you know, maybe as we hominids came up, right, there was some element of display there. Maybe it's just code for some kind of genetic marker for fitness. I don't know. The honest answer is we don't know, but that's one interpretation. So what has all this got to do with the archers? You may well ask. Well, with the archers, we have an audience like yourselves who have a forensic knowledge of people based only on their personalities and characters. So it does seem like a great way to test, to say, well, actually, if willy size is inferred from personality, could we find it with an audience like yourselves who understand these people very, very intimately? So we had two hypotheses. So basically was, is there a link between value judgments and willy size? We'd have been astonished had we not got that, because that's commonly kind of big car, small willy thing, so we just wanted to find that. But secondly, was there this kind of connection between the concept of fear, intimidation and penis size within the characters, within the archers? So we created a questionnaire, looked at four main personality traits, positive social status, negative personality. The ones I think we're more interested in were going to be physical strength and how scary the character was perceived as being. And, of course, we asked how big their willy was, or people thought their willies were. And Cara, because I knew nothing about it, Cara chose the characters, and I knew that there was the abuse thing that was talked a lot about this morning. I knew that that was a storyline, and I said, well, you can put... In, if you put him in, you can, because I won't know him from Adam. She fell about laughing because there's apparently a character called Adam. Anyway.
So, yeah, So Alistair basically said, can you come up with the 10 names, these 10 male characters in the Archers that we can base this questionnaire on? And it was kind of arbitrary, but the Rob question was a big one. Do we include him or not? Because I knew we were looking for scariness and those kind of sort of attributes of people, and Rob would be an obvious one. But to not have Rob in this either seemed completely wrong as well, when he was, and particularly when we're doing this, really, you know, such a huge character in it. So my role in this really was to come up with the, very random, I guess, but that'd be something subjective in my choice in it as well, of the names that we were including in it, and also to tinker with some of the questions, and we'll see those as we go along as well. So these are some of the findings, the key findings that we got from the questionnaire. So who do you think is the tallest of the characters? David came out very much the tallest there. Everybody else kind of fair to middling. William just about getting over, you know, higher height than others. Who do you think is most attractive for their age? I discovered in this questionnaire that I have a bit of a soft spot for Brian. but Tom comes out as the most attractive. I really didn't understand that. And Toby down, you know, Toby again, I think was a bit of a surprise. Obviously, his Lothario ways have worked across the radio on you, and you've all been seduced by him. But Jim was in there too, as somebody that's quite attractive. Maybe that says something about the age range we have here. The most positive social status. I wasn't at all surprised by this, and it was David. I don't really like any of the characters. I don't really like David, but I wasn't really that surprised that people saw him as having the higher social status in The Archers. The show's named after his family, for starters. Mm-hmm. And Jim was up there too, because obviously as a member of the intelligentsia, as amongst us here today, Jim obviously has very positive social status. Who do you think is the most charismatic and would be the most likely to sweet talk another character to help them to do an unpleasant job like muck out the pigs? Rob was really low on that, but perhaps it's because we've heard Jazza and his mucking out of the pigs quite a lot. He was up there too, and Toby was also seen as that kind of charmer to inveigle people, you know, to come along and help do the work that he doesn't want to do. Well, all of the work he doesn't want to do. If one of the characters borrowed another character's tractor and accidentally drove it into a deep part of the river, who is the most likely to be forgiven? There's a lot of men there that we would forgive in Ambridge, it would seem. We would not forgive Brian, probably because he could probably afford 10, or, well, perhaps not in coming storylines. William and Roy and Jim were also quite low on that, but David, Tom, Jazza, Edward were all seen as you know, characters that we can easily forgive. Total negative personality. No surprises there. And this is what I mean. Obviously, Rob in this was going to skew some of those results in a way so much to one extreme. But Toby's making an appearance there too as somebody that is perceived as having a negative personality. Rob was also ahead in all of these categories of questions as well. So somebody who's going to pick on somebody and bully them, who's going to be dishonest, who's you're going to be most intimidated by, who's going to be devious and manipulative, and obviously the character who is the most disliked. Who thinks and acts like they know the most but actually knows very little and is most overconfident? Rob and Toby aren't coming out very well in this questionnaire at all overall, but for very different reasons, I think. Total physical strength. Jazza won on this one quite conclusively. Edward and William, again, I guess, you know, characters that are still quite sort of physical in their work, they were coming out quite strong as two. Toby, who seems to really do nothing apart from, well, he made an appearance taking a cup of tea over to Pip, doesn't really do that much activity, unless driving down to Brighton is considered a physically strengthful activity, but he's up there too. If the characters took part in an arm wrestling contest in the Summer Fete, who would be the winner? Obviously, Jazza and Edward, that would be a battle to the death, I think, with those two quite easily pitched there. But Jazza coming out of somebody that's obviously got, you know, quite a lot of, you know, physical strength attributes to him too. If there was a lock-in at the Bull with free beer, who would be the last man standing? He did this obviously before the vet came on the scene. But conclusively there, Jazza. And I think, obviously, Toby and Brian have got a fairly high alcohol tolerance there, one with a very, very well-stocked cellar that is sort of dipped into quite often, and Toby with his, you know, constant gin testing as well. If there was a zombie apocalypse in Ambridge, and they'd used up all the ammunition, who would be able to fight off the zombies? Jazza is our hero. And I think he was my hero last night, actually, with Tom. I do love Jazza, actually, a bit. But he would be the person that we'd want tooled up in front of us fighting off the zombies. And then the total scary. And again, here we come back to Rob, and he's just a scary character. Brian, I know that I can see, for me, Brian is kind of scary in that he is somebody of... He can be quite pompous and supercilious and kind of talk down to you. And that, for me, can be a little bit intimidating, and there's a bit of scariness in that. So that's my understanding of the Brian one. But Toby's up there too. I think Toby's quite inert. I don't find him scary at all. I don't know how you feel about that one. But I was quite surprised by that result as well. And Jazza too, I just think Jazza's just quite lovely.
Yeah, we did put kind of some related questions that we thought might be relatively entertaining. Clearly they are. I don't understand why. Anyway, but so we're going back to the sort of the hypothesis we sort of started looking at. Firstly, is there a link between value judgments and personality and penis size? And we were going to expect that something was going to happen, and clearly Rob did have the smallest willy. Unsurprisingly, as a friend of mine who did the survey for us, she sort of chatted with us and said, yeah, he's compensating for something, isn't he? But, of course, there's no reason why you should make that judgment at all, because there's no correlation between any kind of personality and penis size. And who had the biggest willy? Well, that was Jazza. I'd love to know why you think that's funny. I don't understand.
Stop listening.
I'll have to start listening. Okay, right. So clearly, we did have there was a variety amongst all of them. Interestingly, those who rated the big ones were actually significantly larger than those who said the small was small, but that's probably another paper, some other point. But the quick question was there a correlation between the personality traits we looked at and these estimates of penis size? I mean, we were going to do a massive study and try and get loads of people in, but we ended up with about 120 people, so this really, it's really kind of sort of speculative pilot data. But And also, we decided to take Rob out of the analysis because clearly he was going to be an outlier for all the reasons that were outlined this morning. And when you do that and you put together the physical strength metric and the scariness metric, you get this astonishing correlation of nearly 1-to-1. Bizarrely, it does seem to follow that there does seem to be this combination of what maybe might be intimidation, physical intimidation when you meet them. There's something going on there. I mean, as I say, I wouldn't sort of hang the hat on this as kind of like a hard empirical finding. Oh, God, I did it again, didn't I? It's so hard to give this talk without slipping in. You know what I mean. Anyway, so as a piece of pilot data, actually, there may well be something going on, and then this kind of idea that nobody had really tested with this kind of an idea of fear and penis size was actually true or not. This is sort of speculative data, but actually, there may be well something there. Thank you very much indeed.
Right, thank you. Ready for the next presentation?
Right, we're going to present case studies of two disparate but linked families who live in and around Ambridge to show that, contrary to tabloid stereotypes, the underclass is not necessarily more dysfunctional than the middle class. And we're also perhaps going to show why Brian has a bigger willy than Jazza. And I can tell you later why Jim's sexy. So, a quick word on ethics approval. We've got ethical approval from Borchester University. All of the information in case studies is usually anonymised, but because the information that we're going to provide was also included in national newspapers such as the Telegraph, the Guardian and on the BBC news sites, we decided that this would actually be okay to use names. One of the families has tried to get a super injunction but were laughed out of court. So, to analyse the families, we've used genograms, and so we'll start off by explaining what they are, how they're used, propose a definition of what we mean by dysfunction in families, and then discuss the case studies. When we started, we actually managed to link virtually every single resident in Ambridge into one big genogram. We realised that this would take longer than 15 minutes to discuss. We also had the difficult choice of who to actually choose as our case studies, because every single family in Ambridge has dysfunctional issues. So we've chosen the Horribins and the Aldridges because they're linked through Christopher and Alice, and we're going to focus on sex and crime, really. Okay. Right, so family trees, we've all seen family trees, we know what they look like. This is obviously from a family who big themselves up because they've had their family tree made into a tea towel. But we're going to use genograms, and genograms are like family trees on steroids. They include psychosocial elements as well. And what we do is we represent men by squares and women with females. We link them together, but we include psychosocial details as well. So things like relationships, negative ones, conflicts, helpful close relationships, behaviours that might affect the family members, and the kind of thing that Jennifer was talking before the break in her keynote speech. So you can actually see it in diagrammatical form. And we've used these to understand some of the family relationships within the Aldridge and Horribin families, and we're going to compare them as well. And we're also going to look at how the class system affects how we perceive the misbehaviours. So, what do genograms tell us about families in Ambridge? As I said, almost every resident in Ambridge can be connected in one genogram, mostly through sex. We can highlight the behavioural characteristics, and we can compare them. So we're going to focus on sex, marriage, parenting and facilitating, and the crimes committed by members of each family. Then we're going to have a quick look at the similarities and differences between Jenny and Susan.
So, what's a dysfunctional family? What does it look like? Dysfunctionality could be different, and we make no apologies for a Wikipedia reference, because it's quite a good one, this one. It looks at misbehaviour and conflict within families. It looks at issues around child neglect, child abuse. So thinking back to the forensic psychology side of it, you know, what are the antecedents to people's behaviour? How can you see that in the families and the structures of the families and the way that cycles of behaviour happen generation after generation? And the important thing about thinking about dysfunction in families is that it's not just a matter of one-off incidents. This is the normal script of their lives. It's how their lives are generally lived. So this is not one-off incidents. So what does it look like? Is a dysfunctional family something from Benefit Street, something from Shameless, a family who's likely to be seen on Jeremy Kyle? That sort of stereotypes around quite a lot. Or could a dysfunctional family be much more to the manner born, middle class, well respected, doing all the sort of things? I mean, that does look slightly like Brian there in the middle there. Yeah, okay, enough said. Right. So a genogram, complex.
So this is our genogram, and it's of the Audrey family. We've pared it right down so that only the important people are actually shown, because the software actually had a morality check and went haywire. Sorry, I have got a tonsil problem. So, we start off, if we look at Jenny, she had an illegitimate child in 1967 and refused to... Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And didn't make a father. It turned out when Adam was born with a lovely shock of red hair that he was the son of Paddy the cowman. She then went on to marry Roger, who adopted Adam, and they had Debbie. She quickly divorced him, had a cerebral affair with... Oh, she married Brian next, and then had a cerebral affair with John. This was shortly after she had just given birth to Kent. Brian, in the meantime, was busy flirting and shagging anything that would be a couple of feet of her. So, and that is why he's got the biggest willy in Ambridge. His libido is huge. So he couldn't really give up Caroline, which caused a few problems between them. So they decided to have make the marriage better child, Alice. And he carried on with his flirtation, including Betty Tucker. I was quite surprised by that, because I always imagined Betty to be really old and frumpy. We got Marie-Claire, and then we have the famous Siobhan, who he finally had the wonderful son that he wanted, which was kept secret from Kate and Alice for some time. So there's sort of like lots of affairs and secrets going on. This marriage is not good. This is not how to go about marriage. The next generation guys decided that they carry on the tradition. So we've got Adam, who's not nice and boring at all, shagging farmhands and Charlie and all kinds of people that we don't know about. We've got Debbie, who actually was a mistress of someone. So she's slightly different there. We've got Kate, who's had affairs, untold numbers of affairs, but also abandoned three children. And she's kind of reconciled with Phoebe a little bit, but things are very odd in that relationship. If I was Christopher, I'd be really worried, because those genes ain't good. We've also got some issues in the relationships between Brian and Adam, who he feels he's got a lot of hostility and bigotry towards. But he's very close to Debbie, and this has caused problems between Adam and Debbie too, which I've not put on because it just blocks everything out. So there's all kinds of stuff going on there. And what do we think? We think Brian's a cad. He's like, do we call Jenny a tart? Well, no.
Jenny, darling.
Kate, she's a bit of a hippie. She's a bit flighty, isn't she? So we look at the Horribles. Neil was offered it on a plate, and he stayed faithful to Susan. They've got a really good marriage. Emma, despite going on Jeremy Carr's paternity test, because she didn't know who George wanted, has got a rock solid marriage with Ed. So we've got a really good marriage in here. Bert and Ivy, they stayed married for a long time. You've got a lot for the family. But Susan's a bit of a hero. She really loves Alice. It improves her social status. She's been very positive towards Emma and Ed. She gave them somewhere to live when she had them and left Will. She's helped Clive. She hid him from the police. She took in Tracy when she became homeless and facilitated sharing Bert's home so that she could actually help look after Gary and Bert. Both Bert and Gary are pretty useless, but what do we think of them being useless? We want them to get off the backside and actually do some cooking and cleaning. Brian, we all laughed earlier on when we found out you needed to phone people up to help him in the kitchen. So I think we kind of think of the Horribles and the lower social class people quite badly compared to the more middle class types. So I think this is just a quick summary. The whole thing, look after their own, they're supportive of each other, they have a linchpin of a family who they can rely on, they have strong marriages. Whereas the old ages, there is no family loyalty either. There's widespread adultery, jealousy, bigotry, favouritism, children with lost their fathers, even worse than William Johnson, and child abandonment. Who is worse, the old ages or the horrible ages?
So let's have a quick look at criminal activity now. Clive is well documented. He had the armed robbery on the village shop. He then escaped from prison. He was hidden by Susan. That ended up in her going in prison. So he was sort of, he was responsible almost for Susan being put down, put into prison. Wrong word. He's also been convicted for arson, for breaking his licence conditions and so on, making threats to Donna and Tracy. Susan, conviction for perverting the course of justice, custodial sentence. Keith, brother you don't often hear much about. He had a good car business. It started to fail. He went into dodgy car deals. That got into stolen farm machinery. Wonder whether Ben, Josh, might be getting into that as well. Handling stolen property, a heist went wrong, there was an assault, intimidation of a witness, David Archer at the time, all leading to arson in which George could have died. So, Keith had some real problems there. And Ed, down at the bottom, serious drug problems, been out poaching, fairly minor stuff. He's never done anything to sort of really bring himself to the attention of the police particularly. A bit like his dad. So that's the criminal activity in the Horobin family. So is there any criminal activity in the Aldridge family? A lot of troubles, no connections with the police to so far as I know. Kate was expelled from school. She broke into properties. She was cautioned for that. There was car theft. There was vandalism. She's abandoned children, and for heaven's sake, yes, that is an offence. Child cruelty and abandonment. Against the Horobins, with all their crimes, I would say that these are very much class-based. The Aldridges are crimes of privilege and entitlement. You can walk into somebody's property, you can take their car. Yeah, that's all right. Middle class sort of children getting up to hijinks. The Horobins, though, more serious crimes, but you could see those seriously as linked to poverty and depression. They're to do with a lack of life chances, desperation, being outside the system, being in that grey economy. So some differences, but there are some similarities in the way that you might see dysfunction within the family. And when we look slightly wider of the family, Matt, he was in prison, and we think he may well have murdered his brother or been responsible for the death of his brother, which would at least be manslaughter. Next.
So, for looking at it, we realised as we were looking through, not only is infidelity genetic, but Susan and Jenny have quite a lot of similarities. They were brought up in not dissimilar circumstances. Jack Archer was an alcoholic and gambler. He had a number of jobs and failed enterprises. Jenny was brought up in a pub. They both didn't have much as small children. But the difference is that Peggy, married to Jack too, the new and improved Jack, who also came with lots of money. Jenny bagged Brian, who also came with lots of money. So that gave them opportunities to actually get their children off the poverty ladder. And meant that Jenny could climb a bit further up the social ladder while Susan was still floundering around at the bottom. But Susan's got a heart of gold, and she wants people to like her. So while she actually does some very strange things sometimes, it's because she wants people to like her. Whereas Jenny does things to kind of keep people respecting her and in her status. One of the opportunities that has been given to the Aldridge and Archer children is that they've all had the opportunity to work and live abroad. So Hungary, Africa, Africa, Canada, Africa, they've all been away. Whereas the only Horribin family member was to try to escape with Emma, and they were thwarted by Will when he came and found her leaving. And Christopher almost had a chance to escape, but didn't quite make it because he got kicked in the face by a horse. And this goes, you know, sort of like when you've got privilege, you don't tend to have runs of bad luck like you do when you've got poverty.
Thank you very much.
She is a very pivotal family member, but Susan sort of seems to have the main sort of pivotal role. And in fact, it was Susan who took Tracy in after a failed relationship and brought and negotiated, facilitated her to take on the tenancy with Bert so that he could look after Bert and Gary, who, to be honest, are useless. I'd hate to ignore Tracy because I share a birthday with her.
Children, which is what's happened with the Aldridge children. The Aldridge children have all gone off and gone away and done bigger and better things, whereas Emma's been stuck in a caravan for a long time and living with in-laws and all the rest of it. I mean, I guess Chris has done quite well, but again, you know, he's not rolling in it, and I think he does rely on Alice quite a lot. He's got lucky.
Thank you very much. I think we need to move on, but thank you very much.
There it is. Yeah, you haven't heard it yet. So I'm just sitting through the Helen and Rob papers and enjoying the big willies and everything, and I'm such a heinous nerd. This is that brilliant quote that Amber Medland used this morning, that Brillat Savarin thing, show me what you eat and I'll show you who you are. I've always believed, show me your research and I'll show you who you are. So people that are fabulously detailed, forensic, that is not me at all. But, so here it is anyway. This paper comes out of a genuine purpose, which has been work that I've been doing from a kind of sociological and anthropological perspective, looking at the dimensions of place-based power. So there are debates about that the way what happens within a place is affected by a number of different dimensions. So what I'm going to lead you through, before you're allowed to eat your lunch, so hold tight. So the small worlds of Ambridge, and it's a brilliant link actually to the Genogram paper. I love the way they said, it is possible to link all the families together, but who'd be stupid enough to try that? So, conceptual, theoretical background, layering dimensions of place-based power. What do we mean when we talk about power? Networks and deep structures. Then we'll look at the empirical data. It's all carried out with good ethical clearance, well done everybody for reminding me of that, in a small village you might know, located in Borsetshire, called the village of Ambridge. I'm going to introduce to you the current matriarchal structure and cliques of the village. Some emerging contractual and brokerage structure that's around the economic sociology of Ambridge. As we all know, it's got some odd features, economically speaking. We'll look at the intimate network, and then we're going to look a little bit hence what might play out in terms of these networks and structures for the future. That's what I'm going to do. So I'll get on with it, because I've got 87 slides here. You think I'm joking there with 87? Right. Dimensions of power. That looks good, doesn't it? Massive. So, as I've said, my main normal work, when I'm not being abused and tortured into working for the Archers most of the time, is this thing, place-based statecraft. And we encourage city leaders, policymakers, to think of why what happens normally in cities, it's an urban field of scholarship, to look at, it isn't just who is the man with the big clipboard or who is the elected official, there's lots of dimensions that affect what happens within a place. And so there's a lot of literature, particularly anthropological literature, about something about a small place, so Ambridge. There's a frequency of interaction, something about the territory itself that speaks. Those people are interrelated, there's interrelationships going on all the time, and I love this word, propinquity. It just means those things all together. So we often say that it's a sort of thing in urban studies. Why would you study an urban elite rather than a national elite? And it's the gift of propinquity. You're close to them, so you can get to know them well. So scholars... Oh, yeah, and there's affect. And all of this is not written down. You can't really find it. But it's how people feel about their interactions with one another and the place and all the rest of it. So that's that. There's a lot of scholars, and again, political scientists, who holds power under plural governance forms requires that us, as analysts of that power, pay attention to all the multidimensional factors concerning how people interact. So if somebody says, why is Manchester the way it is? I might have a few things to say about that. It took me 5 years to write them down, Angela. You watch the process. Why is Manchester the way it is? Well, there's a story you can tell about football teams, there's a story you can tell about universities, there's a story you can tell about inward investment, there's a story you can tell about elite governance forms, the story you can tell about an airport. Then all those things are true at once, right? Like, and they interact in some interesting ways. And that isn't just a political story about this decision was taken in this committee and then this happened in a neat way. It's just nonsense. So power, according to this count, can be wielded as numerous and overlapping forms of embodied capital. Symbolic and cultural capital are in some ways as defining as economic status. And even erotic capital, which let me tell you exists, has been posited as an explanatory frame for understanding differentiation. So a society that values sexiness or any of the other things. So, stuck with the question, who wields power over whom? There are a lot of ways you can look at this. So the genogram paper, absolutely fantastic. In anthropological terms, that all fits under kinship, right? That's who's related to whom. The only way, according to this, that you would have a kin tie with somebody are through birth or marriage. We don't have all the illicit bonking on here, I'm afraid. It comes in another category. Number two, you've got an economic relationship. You've got a contract or a lease or something that was enforceable in law. And that's what governs the most of kind of economic relationships, right? So if someone's your landlord, your tenant, your employer, this isn't a relationship that you can dissolve on a whim on a Wednesday. There's the legal and contractual basis for most economic activities in countries where the rule of law is normal, which apparently that's no longer America. Formal governance roles, MPs, mum's net. I mean, that would be the real power, right? The parish council. Informal governance roles. Anyone doing anything that affects the life of anybody else. So third sector activity, belonging to the WI, belonging to the Mother's Union, belonging to a trade union. Trade union might go be a formal governance role, actually. informal governance roles is the way that people come together to affect destiny collectively. But, as was just mentioned, information sharing, gossip, problem solving, and then intimate and trust-based networks, these are all other ways that you can wield power. And there's another, and I mentioned this in passing, there's also an argument when you look at networks that sometimes it's none of those things. Something about the weak ties that link people together, there's something else going on altogether, which is a kind of, I suppose, a kind of wild card for this kind of approach. So, in the small worlds of Ambridge, that's the dimensions we've just discussed. Now, this is a big test for my animation. Family ties, birth or marriage. Contractual and employment relations, legal employment or tenancy. Formal governance, church, sorry, I've done this, haven't I? Informal governance, the panto, the save campaign, and the village shop. Information sharing, bridging capital. Problem solving, skills with people or things, reliability, trust, multiple loose connections, and not one strong clique or clan. So there's sort of two areas really on the diagram. One is sort of harder power, and one is softer power. Harder in the top, softer in the bottom. But they have different weights to them. You'd be a fool to argue that running the panto gave Linda Snell the same equivalent power as running Damara. They're different things, right? They're not commensurable forms of power. So, who wields these kinds of power in Ambridge? This is a shouty-outy one, right? Kinship. Who wields kinship power in Ambridge? Who has got a lot of relatives? Peggy. Jill. Joe. Grundy's. Susan. Who has a lot of either employees or tenants? Pat and Tony employ the most people in the village. They're not the most high status jobs, but who isn't trotting in and out of there making yoghurt, witnessing all their misfortune? Formal governance. David. Niel. Oh, not Kenton. So, a key site for informal governance power, the village pub. The pub is the hub of all gossip and information. Actually, also, it's the shop, but... Informal governance, Kenton.
Yeah,
Alan. Linda. Ah, interesting, Alan. We'll come back to him. Information sharing, Jenny Darling. No. She came up last. The point is made, right? They've got different things going on. And in fact, I've put Neil over this side. Alan. Alan came over to problem solving. I thought that...
Yeah.
We'll see this afternoon. Maybe God isn't a problem to be solved, but... So, that was power. All of that can get summed up through the use of networks. And good old Hillary Clinton, remember her? She had a phrase, a book a few years ago, It Takes a Village to Raise a Child, and it was all about her kind of deep belief in kind of activism and you know, why can't we all get along and all the rest of it. And I quite like the phrase, because in the village, we're looking at networks in a village, so it takes a village to do anything. Now, I'm going to skip this, because it's a bit hardcore. You might have to read the book. So, but the first thing that you might need, this. So back to the question, who would be mad enough to map Ambridge? This is a figure from a paper from 1934 by a guy called Jacob Moreno, with whom I am borderline obsessed. He was psychoanalyzed by Freud in Vienna, and then he moved to New York, and he set up what became, he set up all kinds of things, but what became the Journal of Social Network Analysis, and he was completely convinced that psychiatry was all well and good, but what was the point in work one at a time? Why work on one person at a time? What you wanted to do was forms of sociatry. So you needed to work together. It's back to propinquity, relation, all that stuff, all that trust, network building. So Despite the principles being sound, he felt, in his own case, you had to work collectively to develop and to move on. It's the sort of thing that we've kind of forgotten to remember. So we'll keep going through this. We don't need all this. Later, the tools that he developed, that diagram there, was from a monograph entitled Who Will Survive? So he didn't have networks as something frivolous. It was about who would actually make it out of a disaster situation. And weirdly enough, the paper's about downtown Manhattan being cut off by kind of basically a kind of apocalyptic end scenario. And he argued then people that were wielding these different kinds of capital might have survived better than others. Really interesting work. Completely obscure and ignored. Except by me. One place that has been taken up is in economic sociology. This is work from the States by Krebs and Holly, which I use all the time. I use it in local authority settings, asking people to think about their economic development strategy. I use it in team building settings, asking people to think about how they share information. I've used it with the World Bank. I've used it a lot. Now, Krebs and Holly argue the very sort of simple thing, that the things that you do together define this network differently. So you start off, that network is not looking very networky, is it? It's a scattered fragment network. Those people are not connected in any way. On this, the nodes are people. That's a hub and spoke network. What people always do when they try and get things moving, you put a hub in the middle, the pub's the hub in the middle, and that is supposed to build capital out. What always happens is that the hub burns out after a certain amount of time, and you end up back in a scattered fragment situation. Although you need to move through a hub and spoke situation to get near to a small world situation, which is the next developmental stage, which is this. And then if you're really lucky, you've got loads of resources, you've got the wind behind you, the government doesn't change and it's all happening, you might reach towards moving from your small worlds towards a core and periphery model like this, under which innovation or resource can is kind of an anarcho-syndicalist heaven where you don't need any institutions at all because everyone's just feeding each other and it's all marvellous. So that's the end point. You don't see that anywhere in the world. So you might ask. So, having narrowed down the eight dimensions, the doing power and all the rest of it, we've got three areas of network to look at. New research results. Kinship networks, back to the genograms. Doing connections, and we'll come back to that. And the whole village system, which, gosh, that was ambitious. As we've seen, family tree, predictable, hierarchical, represented like that. That, however, is how you look at the cliques, so similar to the genograms, the three cliques of Ambridge. The Grundys, the Brookfield Archers, and the Woolley / Aldridge / whoever, come as you are, it's fine, we don't mind. We're not fussing. Famously, the great Neil Pinnock pointed out that the Archers should be renamed the Grundys and their oppressors. And the Grundy clique is a very interesting one. As we've heard, functionality, dysfunctionality are not the priority of the privilege of either a high or low economic status in Ambridge. This is the Grundy clique. There's 12 of them. They've got Joe as a patriarch. Christ. A couple of people in Ed's generation, including Clary. Then you've got Ed, and then you've got George's generation. So there's four generations of Grundy. They've managed to sustain two households. And they're both in Ambridge. There's Grange Farm. Let's not go into that. And there's wherever Will and Nick have fetched up. I can't even remember. We haven't heard them. When did you last hear Nick? 2013, I think. So another way of looking at the same data looks at who is most central to this Grundy clique. And that is, again, this is by birth or marriage only. So Alf, George is more central than other people because of his mixed parentage, right? Because he's in one family, but we all know he's genetically somebody else's son. Now, this is a very minor clique in the Archers, this family. You may not have heard of them. They're certainly the worst, least interesting, least able to kind of sort themselves out. So they need our sympathy, really. They live at Brookfield, the Archers, you know? There's 18 of them, three generations. This is very interesting. Jill, despite being her kind of behind having all the kind of aesthetics of matriarchy, hasn't managed to produce the fourth generation of Brookfield Archer. It doesn't exist. She's only 7 years younger than Peggy, and Peggy's got 8 in the fourth generation. Why? They've managed to have 4 households running, which you'd expect. 3.5 if you count Rickyard. Obviously, one's Lower Loxley. Brookfield, whatever Shuler's house is called. What's it called? Yeah. The stables. Sounds glamorous. And then there's some outliers to this minor clique in the village. Pip. God. Dan and Dorothy. I have hopes for Dan and Dorothy, maybe. And Fallon and Meriel. They count as... Well, if, frankly, they completely enliven the Brookfield clique, because without them, they're nothing. And that's them. Jill at the centre. And, yeah. This is the major clique in the family. So from a kinship perspective, this is the one you want to be in. This is the strongest clique. There's 29 of them, and there's 4 generations. Well done, Peggy. You've begat who have begat who have begat. There's 9 households. Well done, team. We've got independent living. The only people within this situation with the conventional normative nuclear family are James and Leonie. Go figure. How? You tell me, how? I'll ask again, how? How have we produced a childless Adam, a childless Debbie, a childless Rory, well, he's only 9, and Alice and Chris, in whom I have hopes. We'll see why in a moment. So matriarch in generations, we won't did it on this too long, but again, according to kinship, as your only measure, people who are wielding generational kinship power in Ambridge are Jill, Peggy, Joe, in the order Peggy, Jill, Joe, right? Now this is the bit that you say, who would try and link them all together? This is the Ambridge Kinship Network Structure 2017. I've stopped all the big changing to the size of the Kamada Kawai algorithm has been disabled, which means the things are the same size. But they are still according to how the cliques link. And the only way to get the whole village to link is using the dead. So you'll see George, Christine, Dan and Doris there. There's a hinge between the clique of the Brookfield Archers and the clique of the... Who's that? Homefield and Brookfield Archers, right? Because obviously Dan and Doris linked all of that up there. As we can see from the next slide. So the Brookfield Archer, that pathetic clique, the home farm and Aldridges, and yeah, come as you are, the Bridge Farm Archers, the Snell clique, hanging off the bottom here. I couldn't remember everybody's names. The Persephone, Leonie, Corianne. Wasn't they the llamas?
No.
Constanza. What were the llamas called?
Constanza.
Well, they're not on there because they're llamas. It was a goat. Oh, a goat, right.
Persephone was a goat. Persephone was a goat. And Salieri and Constanza were the llamas.
You anarchic bunch.
Right, people were the llamas.
Between the cliques, though, there was something very interesting going on. The cliques are quite stable. Well, apart from... Forget that. The cliques exist. Between the cliques, you've got... bridging capital, right? Some of them are dead. So this top clique, which has got George Barford, the only person remaining in there is Auntie Christine. Then, again, I have high hopes down here. So the two loops down here that will significantly and materially affect the kinship structure of Ambry. What? I've got 7. I'm in these 2 yellow circles at the bottom. Alice and Chris, and the nuclear family emanating from Leonie and James, because that would link the Bellamys and the Snells together. As you can see here. And there. And some other places. I don't really recognise this. Yeah. Network theory, not just me, suggest that in kinship terms, the key nodes to watch out in the extended network are offspring of Chris and Alice, James and Leone. James and Leone already have a child called... There, bridging capital, brokerage, and centrality could create new dynastic power. And that has consequences both up and down the generations. It disrupts the settled matriarchy. It disrupts the flower and produce making matriarchs and potentially creates novel power bases in the future between the Aldridges and Carters, brackets, Horribins, go the Horribins, and the Bellamy and Snell dynasties merging. Now, what could happen there? Right. We're moving on. Oh! Kinship conclusion. Well, I can't get it back. No, this is all right. We're right here. The 2017 matriarchal structure will not outlive Jill and Peggy. That's how many years can be left in them. Watch for Alice and Chris or any movement of Leonie and James back to the village. The interconnected granny power of the mother and mother-in-laws could transform the structure of kinship in Ambridge. Brookfield Archers and their reproductive strategy is key. They are late to the party, but so far are showing no skills in this regard. This is where it gets really complicated. This is what I was going to do the paper about at the beginning, which was that sometimes when you're looking at layered dimensions of power, the things that are exerting power aren't people, they're things. So, the built environment of Ambridge, for example, and I had a long list. Let's see if I've got it here. No. So, particularly as plot devices, non-human actants move the story on in some very specific ways. Think of tuna bake, custard, Otto the Bull, Home Farm, Bridge Farm, St. Stephen's, Lakey Hill, Scruff. The point is, sometimes the things that exert power and agency aren't people, they're things. And this, nosebleed, shows some of the ways in which the built environment and objects in the village are linked together. But this is connected with that other point about contractual and legal relationships, because the economy is made of a mixture of people and things doing things. Can someone nod, please?
Yes. Well,
yeah. Yes. According to this, your contract and employment and your membership of some formal and informal governance bodies and your mastery of things create a different kind of capitalism, a different kind of network. And this is all about how well you are linked to the people and things of contract and employment. It creates a completely different set of cliques. It's got Bridge Farm, the Bridge Farm clique, Home Farm, very interesting in Home Farm, according to this, Jenny and Brian have both got similar amounts of power, but Brian's is arguably in more high status things and Jenny's is in lower status things, but they've got the same amount, which is very interesting. Brookfield, let's not even go there. Their business strategy is absolutely appalling. If it wasn't for those lovely fair brethren doing diversified things around the edges of the farm, Brookfield, anyway, enough. Meanwhile, yeah. When you link people and things together and you look for the most linked people and things, you create this diagram. And I'm not sure if you can see who is King of Ambridge in this scenario. Ed Grundy. Now, it is fair to say Ed Grundy has not been the King of Ambridge to this point, but maybe we don't know enough about the structure of the knowledge economy. In the knowledge economy, we try to approach innovation across networks. The contemporary knowledge economy privileges multiple connections and the possibility for the diffusion of knowledge through the combining of new knowledges in new contexts. Knowledge as capital may displace ownership of land and property in this economy. And ownership will continue to be immaterial. Think of the gig economy. Nobody owns anything, but everybody's just circulating value without any connections. Could Ed inherit the earth in the knowledge economy of Ambridge? If he could convert his network centrality, openness and connectedness into capital and thus land, his clan and clique will inherit. It's the last one. This is the intimate network of Ambridge. And this got so complicated I had to give up on the names because it just went on and on and on. Less said about this, the better, I think. So, I'm finishing. No, I'm really finishing. So, if we take all this analysis into account, you've got two scenarios I have sketched out for the future of the village. Number scenario one is clan continuity to 2037, looking over a 20-year horizon. Number two is the Headlam hypothesis. The Headlam hypothesis posits a generational networked power shift. It argues that the future kinship structure of the village and the hinges, James and Leonie, Alex and Chris, if they have families in Ambridge, their 2037 matriarchy displaces existing matriarchs in favour of Lillian, Linda, Susan and Jennifer. And wouldn't that be nice? Think of the storylines. The knowledge economy centrality structure, Ed, King of Ambridge, his wife Emma, Fallon and Alice have got brokerage capital. If they can monetise these, then they can create prosperity from themselves, both for their offspring, but also their parents, which makes the status and prestige of Susan, Neil, Clary, Eddie, Jolene, Kenton, and Jenny and Brian rise. Not to mention their existing and potential offspring. That's it.
Kingdoms when Edwards and Emmas were kings.
Good.